Good evening. Good evening. So, Your Excellency, Monsignor, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, because we are all brothers and sisters in St. Francis, after all. Good evening to everybody. I'm Father Mario. I am one of the 52 friars who minister in the Basilica, and I'm also the editor of the Messenger of St. Anthony. On behalf of the rector of the Basilica, Enzo Poiana, of our provincial, Giovanni Voltan, and the general director of the Messenger of St. Anthony, welcome to all for our round table on proclaiming the word in the year 2025, the future predicted by web evangelizers. First of all, I'd like to introduce our guests. We have the full lineup of speakers for the workshop, and very pleased to say that we have a great diversity of expertises and perspective in the room. We have, first of all, our two chairmen. We have the Most Reverend Antonio Mattiazzo, Bishop of Padua. Then we have Monsignor Paul Tai, Secretary of the Pontifical Council for Social Communication. And then we have all our panelists. And we have, first of all, Ruth Morris. We will say a few words what they are later on. Then we have Jesus Colina, Roderick von Hogan. Then Eric Salobir, unfortunately, couldn't be here because he had to leave, but he left us a video message. And then we have Marco Sanavio, director and one of the organizers, and Giulia Cananzi from the Messenger of St. Anthony. The organizers wishes to thank, first of all, the students of the Salesian University Institute in Venice who have come here with their dean, the dean of the Faculty of Communications, Professor Diotto. Is he here? Hi. They will tweet, the main contents during the round table. Then the organizers wish also to thank Product Lab, Experiential Technologies, 10iCube SRL, who have offered us the service of augmented reality during the meeting. I think it was a very good idea from the organizers to have this meeting in this hall, which is next to the main cloister of the Basilica of St. Anthony, because St. Anthony was an extraordinary communicator. We know from historical document that St. Anthony was such an extraordinary preacher that wherever he went, thousands and thousands of people ran there to listen to him. And generally, he couldn't preach in churches. He generally had to preach in large squares, in open spaces. And before becoming a Franciscan, Anthony, his name was Fernando, by the way, but Fernando was a canon regular of San Agustin. And so Anthony was very well prepared in both, the theological and human sciences. And so when he was preaching, all his sermons were scripture-based, but he was constantly, draw examples from the book of nature. But what was exceptional was the fact that he was very, very good in speaking, so that anybody was able to understand him, even children. So he used a very, very simple word. As I said, he was a learned person. So learned that Francis himself appointed Anthony as the first teacher of theology in the Franciscan order. So he was very talented, but he was able to speak in very, very easy terms. Sometimes when we watch television and we see, people speaking, especially politicians, and they use difficult words, we say, oh, they must be very intelligent. They are not. They try to confuse you. The very intelligent person is the one who is able to communicate in easy terms. And Anthony was really like that. But Anthony was not only a very, you know, talented speaker. He was always, and also, you know, deep in his heart, he felt the Franciscan charisma. And so he was very close to anybody who was in need, especially the little ones, the marginalized. He was constantly at their side. He could be defined in modern terms as a human rights defender. He was constantly on the side of the poor, of the little ones, the children, the elderly, women, because the situation of the women were far from rosy in the Middle Ages, and also prisoners. So Anthony was quite tough, and in fact, he could be quite hard, especially against all those who took advantage of the poor, especially, you know, usurers, tyrants, and even corrupted clergy. So, I mean, Anthony was not a pretty face. He was really quite hard. And just to give you an example, he was also fighting in the political forum, and he was even able, he succeeded even, in changing unjust laws. There was a law in Padua that if you were not able to pay your debts, they put you into prison, which was something very common everywhere. But Anthony said, this is very unjust. If you put somebody in prison, he will never be able to repay. And so he succeeded eventually to change the law from prison to banishment from the city. So, as I said, Anthony was extraordinary. When he died, all the people, thousands of people were following his coffin during the funeral, were crying like baby because they felt they had lost Father Anthony. Father who was not, because he was a priest, but because he was a real father to them. Somebody who was who had generated faith in them, but was also constantly defending and taking, you know, defending, caring about them. So we can say, in short, I've finished now, that the pillars of his extraordinary talent were effective, a simple language, the truth of the gospel, true interaction with people, authentic witness. He lived what he preached. Nowadays, would St. Anthony use the social media? I don't know. Would he say, tweet others as you would wish to be tweeted? I don't know. It is certainly a good title for a book. This is a book which has just been published by the Australian Catholic Bishops Conference. So, I mean, it means that the Church is quite interested in social media. So now I give the floor to Bishop Antonio, who will open this round table. Thank you.
First of all, I'm pleased to greet all of you who take part in this meeting. In fact, it is a singular and a very original meeting because for the first time it gathers different personalities who make use of technological tools for the spreading of the Word of God. The source of these experiences is common to us all, but it is carried out in different ways. So I think that it's very interesting to compare these different experiences in order to go on in a more perfect ways. I will tell you how I decided this project is called Attimo di Pace, Moment of Peace. First of all, I was aware that many people today make use of this technology, these digital tools. At the same time, I was very aware that it is an essential task of the Church to announce the Word of God to everybody. So I asked myself, why we do not use more deeply, more widely, digital tools for preaching the Word of God? And having in mind this idea, I have a knowledge that the Dominicans of Lille, they proposed the experience called Retreat in Town. Myself, I was formed in French culture and I lived for 3 years in Paris, and I still follow the way of acting of French Church. So the experience of the Dominicans was for me very interesting, and I thought that we could apply this experience to our local church. And first of all, I shared this idea with my collaborators of the Office of Pastoral Communication. And today they are very expert, more expert than myself on this field. They accepted this idea. But at the same time, we try to gather different people and the communities in fostering this project. So we called to the Jesuit, to the Franciscan of the Basilica, and other people. And we discussed this project, which was gladly accepted. So we started. So the reasons of this project are very clear to me. I think that it is in certain way also not only important, but it is necessary also for the Church to communicate through these digital tools. But at the same time, the way of life of people today are not so disposed to a long speech in the church on reading. They go to work, they travel, so it is important that this announcement of the Word of God should be applied to these different ways of living of people today. And so the Word of God demands that it should be presented in a simple but incisive ways, and very short. This is not so easy, but because it is easier to make a long speech than to synthesize a speech, a message in a short way, short words. It was, also for me a challenge, because you know the priest and the bishop today, we make a long speech. For me, it was also a challenge to gather the message in a few words, but very appropriate words. But it was a very interesting experience. What is the purpose then of this project? A moment of peace is like a seed that is scattered everywhere. And the ground on which the seed falls can be the most varied. I thought surely they would benefit those who already are willing to hear the Word of God. But at the same time, I suggested that given the widespread use of these tools, one could reach the people who are in search of spirituality, in search of something new, and do not attend regularly the Christian community or are attracted by the curiosity of the proposal. So I suggested sending daily fragments of the Word of God that could feed the desire of all different people. The Church can't keep for herself the Word of God that she received, but she feels that she has to spread it to the whole world. Starting from Pentecost, it is her task to announce the word to the whole world. And thanks to the internet, a moment of peace can quickly reach every corner of the planet, like Padova, but also New York, London, Bethlehem, Australia. I like to recall this vision of Pentecost. First of all, the Church make on it of the first apostles, of the disciples, with Mary are gathered in the upper room, the cenacle. And they receive the fire of the Holy Spirit. But then they not stay there. They open the door and they go to the square of Jerusalem. And now, today, the square is the global village. This seems to respond well to the idea of a church, like Pope Francis said, the French, that go outside. Chiesa in uscita. And that is what I thought about when I chose also my episcopal motto, which is Recapitulare Omnia in Christo. And the coat of arms graphically represents this message, the open book of the gospel and the cross from which all the rays that go to the world depart. But at the same time, they return to a center of unity of all things, that is Jesus Christ. This is the vision of the Church that certainly is also expressed by a moment of peace. So, thank you very much.
Thank you, Bishop Antonio. Thank you very much. And now I would ask Monsignor Paul Tai to give his speech.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. I'd first and foremost like to thank His Excellency for hosting us, for his initiative with the Attimo di Pace, and for his support for social media in general. The title this evening, Imagining the Church in 2025, is a little frightening. I think we want to be very humble. We'd want to be very cautious before we think we can know where we will be in 10 years' time. If we had been here 10 years ago, in May 2005, YouTube was 1 month old. Facebook was 1 year old and was only used in universities. Twitter would not be around for another year. iPhones would come 2 years later. And these are the things that are essential today, didn't exist 10 years ago. So when we look to the future, we need to be flexible because we don't know what the technologies will be. But more important than the changes in technology is the change in the culture of communications. Young people today are living in a different world to the world in which I grew up. I have 15 nephews and nieces between the ages of 7 and 30. They are living in a very different Ireland to the Ireland I grew up in 30, 40 years ago. They are learning differently. I used to have to go to libraries, they go to their computer. They are getting information differently. When I was young, we all stopped to watch the news at 9 o'clock, but nowadays people get their information very differently. They are forming their opinions very differently. They are forming friendships and relationships and keeping those friendships and relationships very differently. When I left school in 1975, I said bye-bye, and I never saw most of my schoolmates ever again. That's changed. People are constantly in contact with their friends. Their way of forming community has changed. The way in which they can maintain relationships and form groups. So for young people today, they are living in a different world. And for the church, we need to recognize the reality of that world, the importance of that world, and we need to learn, in a sense, a new language and a new way of being in a different type of world. My Archbishop in Rome, Archbishop Celli, constantly says, we must ask the right question. We shouldn't ask, how will we use new technologies to evangelize? We should ask, how are we going to be present in the new world that is made possible by the technologies? How are we going to be present in a world that has its own customs, that has its own culture? The first thing I think we need to do is leave behind us the real and the virtual. Stop making a distinction between the real and the virtual. Most people today live in a world where they live online and offline, and their experience of each enriches the other. So it's not as if I get an electronic transfer for money, that's real. If something tells me or I see something happening, I put it online so it becomes real for other people. So we need to be present because we need to know that the digital is part of the existential reality of so many people, that as a church, we must be present. But we must be present in a way that is authentic. And the big change that I think is happening is we're back again where information is exchanged in the context of relationships. We communicate to exchange information, but we communicate also to form community, to form relationships. We will only be listened to, our information will only be taken seriously if we have been able to build relationships. So a key issue for the church is how we can witness in the digital space as a presence that people are attracted to. Word we have used here is how will we proclaim the Bible? How will we proclaim our faith in the year 2025? I think in 2025, we will speak less of proclamation and more of sharing. We will share our faith because if people see that our faith is something that gives us life, that gives us hope, that gives us strength, then they will want to know about that faith. So unless we are authentically able to witness to our faith by being people who spread joy, by being people who support others, by being people who encourage, then it will be very difficult for us to communicate. And Pope Francis has already said that to us. He said, on the social media, our first task is to listen, to understand the people with whom we are sharing this world. The second task is to converse, to talk with them, listening and talking with them. And the final thing is we should always be encouraging, supporting, helping, and encouraging people who very often have difficult lives. But we encourage them with the hope that comes to us as a gift. We are lucky enough as believers to know of God's love for us. We are lucky enough to know that Jesus loves us unconditionally. This gives us a reason for hope. It gives us a reason to encourage others. And that is where we begin. How can we share that gift of faith with others? How can we do that in a way not to impose things, not to oppress them, but to offer them something that is of real value to us? And that is much of the dynamic of the internet. The internet is often driven by people wanting to share their passions, share their hopes, share their enthusiasms. We have to bring our hopes and our enthusiasms to other people. I am hopeful about why we will be able to do this, because if we look at social media, the drivers are connectivity. People want to be connected. Our gospel talks about friendship and talks about the love of God, which is the deepest desire of all people. People talk about the desire also to search. We can help them by finding a truth that gives value to their life. People are looking for following. We can offer them examples of where they will learn of sources that they can trust to guide them in their lives. People want to share. We can teach them that the deepest sharing is self-giving. It's when we give ourselves to other people, when we reach out in love to other people, that we find the deepest meaning of our lives. And finally, it's important to remember that social media, people want to play, want to be entertained, want to be lifted. We can offer them the world of imagination. We can engage not just the intellect, but the hearts of people and offering them hope. So finally, just to, before we talk about, interestingly, I was thinking about May 2005. I planned my holidays and I organized with my parents to come to a little town called Este, which is about 20 miles from Padua. When they were there, my parents fell in love with Este and bought a house there. So that has become part of my life. I would never have foreseen that 10 years ago. But I think more importantly in that time, I've come to learn to value what has happened here in Padua. People in Padua talk not about the Basilica, but about the Santo. They still come to visit the saint, to visit Saint Antonio. He is 800 years dead, and yet he still speaks to people of God's love. Therefore, things are changing, but the message of hope and of joy and of Christ, I think, will be always relevant to people's lives. So therefore, I'm hopeful for 2025. Thank you.
Thank you, Monsignor Paul Tai. And by the way, Monsignor will speak again at the end of the meeting. But now we have the talks of the several panelists, and we start with Ruth Morris, who is in charge of digital communications of the Jesuits in Great Britain, and she will give us a talk about the experience she has with prayer in particular, and something in particular, which is praise as you go.
Hello. As he said, my name is Ruth. I'm from London and I work for the Jesuits. I've been working for the Jesuits for almost 9 years now, and I began working there at the same time as we launched Pray As You Go. It began with a Jesuit, as many things often do, having the idea of using the internet to enable people to pray. With Pray As You Go, we started by trying to provide something of Ignatian spirituality online for people to listen to daily. Yes, to spread the word of God, but most importantly, for people to develop their understanding and relationship with God by reflecting on, with, and through Scripture. Ignatian prayer and reflection with Scripture encourages conversation with the Lord, who talks to the heart to stir action in the world. We've moved from website and podcast in the beginning to multi-language websites, podcasts, and apps. Pray As You Go is now in Spanish, Portuguese, Polish, Vietnamese, Hungarian. I probably have forgotten one. And it's launched in Dutch yesterday. So we've gone from online to in your pocket. We wanted to provide a space and a place for people to have an experience of God in their lives and to provide them with sustenance for the day-to-day small challenges, which we all have, to provide a way of praying and doing that gives witness to that experience. I just want to now play you a short intro to a TED Talk that goes over the last 20 years of technology. I hope it will play. The audio.
Can we switch to the video disc, which is in play mode?
I'm really interested in how you put people and computers together.
We will be using the TV screens or their equivalents for electronic books of the future.
Which is in play mode.
Future.
Okay.
A local area
network
having the
favelas
do something.
It's 5,000 hours music on a compact disc.
Very interested in touch-sensitive displays. High-tech, high-touch.
Not having to pick up your fingers.
Fingers used very, very high resolution.
There is another way where computers touch people.
Wearing.
Physically
wearing.
Onto the screen.
I can't hear what he's saying, but he's going, talking you through the 20 years of technology.
Suddenly, so September 11th,
every year
the world
he would give
got
a talk
bigger.
About future technology, and in 20 years' time, it would come true. So he
Thank
moves
you.
Through the first computers.
When I was asked to do this,
and music,
I was
and how much
also
music people
asked
have, and people
to
taking
look
things
at all
with
14
them,
TED Talks that I had given.
Through to the Google Glass,
chronologically. Thank you.
But what he says at the end of that introduction was that on September 11th, the world changed. But it's not really about September 11th, the reason I stopped it there. What it's really about is about our connectedness, our humanity. I remember receiving a text on my Nokia 7210, for those who remember those, asking for prayers for the families and not believing that what they were saying was real. But in that moment, it was about our connectedness in the face of a tragedy. And since then, the world hasn't stopped getting bigger. Every time there's a human or natural disaster, people are more connected to those lives, those stories, and communities in a way they have never been before. With Pray As You Go, yes, we're encouraging people to pray, but it isn't just themselves and God that we want them to be thinking about. We want to bring them on a journey that takes them beyond themselves, outwards into their online and their offline communities. We want them to pray with that same feeling of connectedness that they have from their online communities during times of tragedy and crisis. This connectedness that developments in technology and especially in social media brings us is more or less what I want to focus on. I've watched so many of those TED Talks, mostly because I enjoy them, and other YouTube videos about future technologies and all the crazy things that might happen. Mostly because I'm a bit of a geek, but also because watching them says a lot about how our future communities and how we have projected our future. We have projected what an ideal future might look like. And what you always see over and over are places where new technologies bring us closer together, where technology helps us to be ever more present to those that are important to us, to our families, our communities. A world where people care for each other and for the environment, where human relationship is the reason for the developments in technology and not the other way around. At the end of that TED video that we couldn't hear, the man's name is Nicholas Negroponte, and he says that his future technology projection for 20 years' time, I think that video is from about 2 years ago, is that we'll be able to change education by being able to ingest it. So we'll be able to eat knowledge. So for example, if I wanted to learn Italian, I would take an Italian pill and hey presto, io parlo italiano. But this could never be the case for the Word of God. As Pope Francis Pontifex tweeted, we can bring the gospel to others only if it has made a deep impact in our lives. The online ventures that have worked powerfully in many people's lives, that we all work on different types of projects, are providing a way for people to recognize God in their daily, ordinary lives. Whether that's through Lego or more traditional ways, they use the medium as vessel, the word as the pathway to God, to make an impact on them, even if it is the tiniest small impact. Because it's something they can carry through their day, through their week, through their month, their year, and the rest of their life. In his message for the 42nd World Communications Day, I think His Holiness Pope Francis discusses three things: community, communication, and collaboration. But I want just to touch on slightly what connects these terms and where technology is taking us now, and where I think the Word of God is and has already been. Within our new non-geographical and very real communities, we have new forms of communication. And with this comes a greater connectedness. We are connected not only by networks and devices, but to each other through the stories we tell, the stories we share, the conversations we have, and the friendships we form. Out of communication comes collaboration. That gives rise to cultural curiosity and creativity. Connectedness and cultural creativity both cross and push the boundaries of community and society. As Christians present in the world, online, in our communities, online and offline, we're called to share our stories, to share our lives, lives that witness to the daily realities of the Gospels, lives that evangelize through their being lived, lives seen through a Google Glass, contact lens, or chip implant, lives lived in a way that provides a powerful witness to the Word of God. With shifts in technology in future, as is now, it is our communities and the way we relate to each other that is impacted the most. But is it the world that is getting smaller, or the reality of human faces drawing nearer and larger? Is technology what is most important for the future of evangelization? I think it will be the way we engage with society in all its forms, the way we frame the choices between what is right and what is the better way. The tech space changes day to day and has no guidebook. Well, we have a Twitter guidebook now, but it doesn't really have a guidebook. Everything Nicholas in that video said was about choice, but not an informed, discerned decision-making process, but a this way is so much easier, why would I do it any other way kind of choice. It takes the line of thinking, if it's easier, it must be better. I don't think that's the case with evangelization. I think you could probably argue the opposite. And again, Pope Francis on Twitter, practicing charity is the best way to evangelize, but practicing charity is probably the hardest thing for anyone to do. But by practicing charity, we provide a credible witness to truth and to the values of the gospel, which is urgently needed. Very similar to what Monsignor Tai said, I don't think we can be credible unless we look at the world as it is and be present. So we can listen to the people of God, their needs, their worries, their lives, so we can give witness to them and enable them to do the same. Thank you.
Thank you, Ruth. And now we give the floor to Jesus Colina, who is president of Alateia and actually founded it. And he will say, you know, what they do. And I'm sure he will also give us some projection about the future.
Okay, thank you, Father. Thank you to the organizers, and particularly to Bishop Matiazzo and Monsignor Taiga. I am involved in an incredible adventure, which is a project that tries to answer to the questions of people in internet, particularly their questions about faith and life, putting together the best answers, the best contributions that the Catholic community is creating and producing in internet. So we are a kind of aggregator. It's called Aleteia. We work in six languages. And I'm very proud to say that the third language in terms of audience is the Arabic language, which is something that says to us how important is the work that we are doing, because a lot of Arabic people are looking for and trying to understand better their lives also. I want to answer to the question of our meeting, proclaiming the world in 2025. And I asked myself, how will the world look in 2025? There is a report published by Thomson Reuters, and they answer to the question offering 10 predictions. I will not offer the 10 predictions because we don't have the time, but at least I will show you three main predictions for 2025. The first is that everything will be digital, from cars and homes that respond to every wish and want, to appliances that think for themselves, to interconnected geographies. Everyone will be digitally directed. Imagine the day when the entire continent of Africa is completely digitally connected. That day will happen in 2025, says Reuters. So how is a life where everything will be digital? There is a second prediction. DNA mapping at birth is the norm in 2025. The evolution of nanotechnology coupled with more widespread big data, technologies that incorporate data from many different people, make DNA mapping at birth the norm, as well as part of one's annual physical exam. This, in one side, will allow disease to be identified, but also will allow all kinds of control and manipulation of people's life. So we could ask ourselves a new dictatorship. And there is a three prediction in the report, which is a multipolar world and terrorism. A global multipolar system is emerging with the rise of China, India, and other countries. At the same time, there are known state actors, businesses, tribes, religious organizations, and even criminal networks that will rise and increase. Opportunities for mass casualty terrorist attacks using chemical, biological, and even nuclear weapons will increase. The practical and psychological consequences of such attacks will intensify in an increasingly globalized world. So we could ask ourselves, a world under the fear. So this is the world. We can ask ourselves, how will the religions look in 2025? In a global village, the population exchanges will increase with new human emergencies, new ways of communication and transportation, and new technologies will put people together, creating a more international, interethnic, and interreligious society. The number of Muslims will continue to grow in the next years, and in fact, in 2050, 25 liters, the number of Muslims will be equal to the number of Christians around the world. And in the same year, in Europe, Muslims will make up 10% of overall population. Atheists, agnostics, and other people who do not affiliate with any religion will increase in countries such as United States or France, but the rate of their growth will decline. It's a bad news for atheists. In general, the population of Buddhists will remain more or less the same, and Hindu and Jewish people will grow, but not too much. So, who will be the people in 2025? There will be three main generations of leaders, of players. There is the generation Z, Y, and X. Let's start with the generation Z. They are born between mid-90s until 2009. And in 2025, they will be between 30 and 16 years old. Generation Z is part of a generation that is global, social, visual, and technological. They are technoholics. They were born in technology. They are the most connected, educated, and sophisticated generation ever in the history of humanity. But because Generation Z have grown up amid terrorism and a dire global recession, they are expected to be more cautious and more skeptical than their predecessors, as well as to have more realistic expectations about career opportunities and relationship in their lives. They will have, and all these things will have a real impact in their relationship with God, in their religious life. After, we have the millennials, or generation, the generation Y. There is a problem here. Well, the generation Y, or millennials, they were born between early 80s and 95. In 2025, they will be 45 and 30 years old. Millennials, there are some of them here, are multitaskers and connected. They know everything there is to know about social media. Millennials are less likely to practice organized religion than older generations, and more likely to be skeptical of religious institutions. A Pew Research Center study in America shows that millennials, only 30% of them in America are atheists, and only 4% of them are agnostics. Overall, 25%, they don't find a religion, they are known. They don't know exactly what they are. And 75% are affiliated, religiously affiliated. And finally, we have Generation X, which is mine, between early 60s, mid-60s and 1980, we will be between 65 and 45 years old. Generation X reacts against religious dogmatism, but is deeply spiritual. However, make no mistake about it, spiritual is no longer synonymous with Christian. The spiritual sense of this generation makes them open to accept Christ, but it also creates an openness to practically everything else. Generation X is investigating a diversity of religious faiths. Many of them are customizing a belief system and a spiritual life from a concoction of various religious streams. In one word, if it works for them, they think that then it is good for them, even when these beliefs have no congruity. Okay, so this is the people of 2025, today. Let's see, I want to share with you five key factors to proclaim or to share the word in 2025. The first is life, not words, as Monsignor Romero witnessed. In one phrase, they want leaders that they live, and not only leaders, they want believers that they live what they preach and that preach what they believe. The key word is authenticity. A second key factor is personal care and love. These generations don't care how much you know until they know how much you care about them. Evangelization without love and charity is a contradiction. Third, religious illiteracy can make the surprise. These generations live in a kind of total religious illiteracy. Sometimes they see the Bible as the Lord of the Rings. They don't know very well the difference. But at the same time, they don't have too much prejudices about the faith because they don't know anything about faith. And this is an opportunity. Christ, the gospel, the Christian values can become the surprise of their life. It means that we cannot take anything for granted. They do not understand theological language. They need simple language as Jesus in the gospel or as Saint Anthony. Evangelizers, they should illustrate in anecdotical form rather than in an outline presentation how a relationship with Jesus brings meaning and purpose in life. Fourth, they don't want ethics, they want an encounter. And remember the beginning of the encyclical Caritas in Veritate, being Christian is not the result of an ethical choice, but the encounter with an event, with a person, which gives life a new horizon and decisive direction. Fourth, digital evangelization, how it will be. There will not be not any more difference between digital and real world, as Monsignor Tari said before. Evangelization is an encounter, we said before, and this encounter will take place in the social networks or with Oculus Rift or in the augmented reality. So there is not any more difference. There is only one exception, the sacraments. The sacraments will not be digital. Confession, I think, will not be digital, and the Eucharist will not be in streaming. So my conclusion is that the evangelization in 2025 will be as the evangelization of the first Christians. First Christians will be our pioneers in evangelization. The master will be always the same, Jesus, and take in our hands the Gospels because there is the way, the truth, and the life. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. And now we give the floor to Roderick. Roderick von Hogen is the founder of StarQuest Production Network, and he will talk about the work he's doing and how he's approaching, you know, people all over the world with his innovative ideas.
Thank you very much. Very briefly, who am I? I am a simple priest from the Netherlands. I've been ordained 15 years ago. And in the same year that I was ordained a priest, I started a website. The internet was still very new. You could get it at the universities, and it was very expensive to have it at home. So I made a website, not about faith, not about the Bible, but about Star Wars. Guerra Stellari. That was my great passion, and I shared it with thousands of people all over the world. And it helped me to make contact with a lot of people that never went to church, never spoke with a priest. But we had a common language, a common interest, and there was a relationship. And that was perhaps the most important lesson of my life, that before you can reach someone, you need to have a relationship, and you have to understand each other's language. Over the past 15 years, I've felt more and more like a missionary who went onto the internet to the ends of the world, like Jesus asks, to reach out and try to make friends. And I do that with every new technology that is available. I started 10 years ago with podcasting, recording audio on my trips to the Vatican or elsewhere in the world. Today, I'm using YouTube, and I create little videos of my visit here to Padua, or this morning we went to the tomb of Saint Anthony, and it's forbidden to film there, but I had a Franciscan friar with me, so I could do it secretly, and I can take people with me and let them discover this beautiful town. The technology is not that important. So I want to share with you very briefly the things that I've learned over these past 15 years. And the question, of course, and the other people have also talked about it, you know, what is the future going to look like? I remember when I was still in seminary, there was a movie called Back to the Future. And in the second part of that movie trilogy, Marty McFly went to the year 2015. I remember seeing that as a seminarian and thinking, I'm gonna be so old in 2015. I'm gonna be 47 years old. To me, it was so far away. And in the movie, you saw what the future was going to look like. Marty had a jacket, and after a rain shower, it would automatically dry in 5 seconds. You would have machines in your kitchen, ovens, that could make an Italian pizza in 10 seconds. Progress. You had TV screens as big as your living room. And most important, most exciting for me, flying cars. Now we know how wrong they were in that movie, because I still don't have a flying car. I don't even have a regular car. I only have a bike, and it doesn't fly. So, what will be the future, 2025? Will we have finally, you know, flying cars? Are we all going to be wearing glasses and living in a 3D virtual world? Are there going to be holographic priests in the churches? And we will clone the priests that we lack? I don't know. If I look at the past 15 years, there is one thing that has changed in the media and in communications. And it's, I think, a very, very important trend that will continue in the future. It is a change from an old style of communication to a new style. And the old style, it was one-way, top-down communication. It's the way that we are very familiar with in the church. I'm a priest, you are parishioners, I preach, you sleep. That is the way we are used to communicating. But it is changing very rapidly, and it's going from a one-way communication to a conversational model. Nowadays, communication is first and foremost interaction, a dialogue, friendship, We talk back and forth. And that, to me, changes everything. I wonder if you know who the most influential person on YouTube is right now. Who is the person that has the most followers and the most impact on the new generation? I'll help you. It's not Don Marco. It's almost, but no cigar. It's not the president of Italy or the president of the United States. It is not even a pop singer or a soccer player, and it's also not Pope Francis. The most important person on YouTube right now is someone you probably have never heard of. It is a Swedish gamer. And his Swedish name is hard to remember, so he calls himself PewDiePie. PewDiePie doesn't mean anything. PewDiePie. Have you ever heard of him, PewDiePie? Oh, one person. That's good. Two people have heard of it. The rest not. He has tens of millions of followers, and they are all between the ages of 12 and 22. The most interesting demographic for marketeers, but also for us as faithful, as a church. And what is he doing? Why is he so special? Why does he have so many followers? He's not bringing news. He's not giving information. He doesn't have a very original philosophy or even religion. What he does on YouTube is he plays video games and he tells jokes. And that's all. Stupid jokes, stupid video games. And you wonder, why are young people watching him? I've asked some of his followers, you know, why do you watch PewDiePie? And they tell me the same thing over and over again. PewDiePie, he's my friend. It's company. When I have to make homework and I don't want to, I just watch PewDiePie, and he talks to me, and he answers my questions, and we have fun. And it makes time go by quicker. It makes my life happier. For me, that is something that we should not look down upon. This is not a negative trend. This tells us something very important about the way that we, as missionaries of the Word of God, how we should and could communicate. It is by having a conversation, by first of all, keeping people company. Now, this is nothing new. The Bible, the Word of God, is not dry theory. It's not a book of theology. The Bible is a book full of conversations, of relationships. It's full of people that we love or we hate. It's a story of how God and man have kept each other company through the centuries. It's exactly the same. The Bible is a book about what we crave, what we need most, and that's friendship and love. So, when we think of the future, we always tend to think of what might change about new technology. But I think it's much more important to ask ourselves, what is going to be the same? And the thing that will remain the same is us, human beings. The things that we will need in the year 2025 is going to be the same thing we need right now. It's friendship. It's love. It's understanding, it's consolation, it's humor, it's joy, all those things. So that helps me also understand how I should proclaim the word between now and the year 2025. I should start with those things. I want to focus on three components of any relationship, and we are all familiar with it. This, I'm not going to tell you anything new. The first important thing if you want to have a relationship with someone, is you need to speak each other's language. And boy, have we forgotten how to speak the language of the young generation. It's not by accident that Pope Francis is repeating over and over again to us priests, to me, that our sermons should not be boring, that people should not fall asleep in church. It should be lively and fun and interesting. It should make you curious and passionate. We have a long way to go. A few weeks ago, I started to post pictures on Twitter of Lego. I was buying Lego figures, little puppets, and I was buying Lego at the marketplace, and I was gathering it. And people started criticizing me, Catholic followers on Twitter. The bishop should intervene. This priest is not serious. He's playing with children's toys. He's wasting his time. He should be praying. He should hear confessions. He should celebrate the Eucharist. As if I don't do that. The reason that I was collecting Lego was that I had a plan to make YouTube videos explaining the big Catholic feasts. Not by preaching, but by creating little stories of Lego puppets. And I would take children back in time to the day of the Ascension, and it would have a little Lego Jesus and little Lego apostles. And I just made another video about Pentecost, and I have 12 Lego apostles, and I created little flames, and I tell the story like that. The contents is the classic story of the Bible, but the language is the language of children today. It's a universal language. It's better than Latin. It's Lego. Every child in the world knows Lego. The second thing for a good relationship, this is so important, but we forget it all the time. A good relationship starts not with you, but it starts with the other. Who are the most annoying people at a reception? Or when you have a party, it's people that walk up to you and only start talking about themselves and never ask you a question. Who are you? Where do you come from? What do you like? People that are full of themselves don't have space for the other. This is also something you find over and over again in the Bible. Take the wedding at Cana. We were at the beautiful chapel with the frescoes. I always forget the name of the family, the chapel. Where were we? Scrovegni. And there is this nice painting of the wedding of Cana, and you see Mary talking to Jesus. And Mary doesn't say to Jesus, they are without the catechism of the church. You have to preach. Mary is like, they have no wine. And in every encounter with Jesus, you see the same pattern. Where it starts is, what do they need right now? They need food. They have no wine. This man is sick. This man is blind. He cannot walk. And the first thing that Jesus asks is not, do you know the Ten Commandments? The first question that Jesus asks is, what do you want me to do? In other words, how can I help you? For me, when it comes to proclaiming the word in 2025, it's all going to be about that question. How can I help you? How can I serve you? What do you need? And start with the simple things, and then just like Jesus, add depth. In my podcast, I talk about a lot of things that you would not expect to hear from a priest. I talk about Star Wars. I talk about the Lord of the Rings. Was written by a great Catholic author. So what I do is I talk about hobbits, and at the same time I also try to educate a little bit what the Catholic thinking is behind that story. I talk about movies, about video games, and I also talk about my faith, but always in a language that I hope is easy to understand. starting with the questions of people and not with my own thoughts. Third rule for a good relationship, and it's already been said by almost all the other speakers, is it's all about love. It's about connections and trust. Show people that you care, that you really care for them. Another example, how do you do that? Well, I'm on Facebook, and a lot of my followers know that I'm right now in Padua. So I told them, I will go to the tomb of Saint Anthony. Do you have an intention that you want me to pray for? You know, hundreds of questions. Please pray for my wife, she's sick. Please pray for me that I can get a job. Please pray to Saint Anthony that I get a new car. That was an American follower. So many questions. And just by asking the question, you show that you care. Don't wait for people to come to you, but first go to them. And the new media, they're not so new anymore, they allow us to do that. Make contact, be friends. When it comes to the future, to 2025, I have a prayer. And it's a prayer to Saint Anthony. I pray to Saint Anthony all the time because I am a scatterbrain. I never remember where I put my glasses or my keys. I forget my password for my computer. And every time I ask Saint Anthony, please help me. And he always does. He is great at helping me find things that I've lost. So my prayer to Saint Anthony for all of us for the next 10 years is, please, Saint Anthony, help us find our tongue, our language, a new language, the language that we've lost, the language of tomorrow, of the young people. Help me to find the people that are lost. Help me to find the people that Christ wants me to find, to bring them to him. I hope you will join me in that prayer. And if there is one thing that I've learned over the years, is that a prayer like that is always answered by Saint Anthony. Thank you.
We thank from the bottom of our heart, we thank Roderick, and now we give the floor to Father Marco Sanavio, who is director of Un Attimo di Pace.
Good evening. We are ending just 10, 15 minutes. I am grateful to Festival Biblico Vicenza, that this is the big environment that contains also Festival Biblico Padova, to the staff of Festival Biblico. And thank you also to Delta R Formazione Media for Learning for live streaming. Good job, Antonio and staff. I also wondered, how can you communicate the word in 2025? Monsignor Teig, we must be humble, but I try to be a bit brave, to imagine something. It's very likely that in the future there will be an evolution of consumer goods due to the personal fabrication. Thanks to the development of 3D printers, it will be easier to obtain objects, tools, and even food in one's own home. On one hand, if this centers the attention on individual, on the other hand, it will risk undermining the community dimension aspect. The church in this context could stimulate an in-person meeting and underline the community dimension of salvation. The newspaper, which is currently identified by a title and a publisher, which should be composed of a series of articles assembled by the user. Why couldn't the same happen to the sacred text and the paths of catechesis for adults? The integrity of information would not compromise, but instead it would change the way we gather content, creating a new customizable language that is best suited for each individual. Looking at from this point of view, the soft copy text, which is free of support, would have much more relevance than hard copy, the physical support, and would become an element with which one could compose the sense and then nonsense in itself. I think the world in 2025 may have three these characteristics: wearable, immersive, edible. Wearable, you spoke about augmented reality, but I have augmented reality. I wear these glasses. Okay. It's wearable and I can interact with the reality. Now we are showing you an experiment of augmented in reality. Okay. You can see it's living now, and I can touch a Bible. Okay, and I can interact with this Bible, and I can see an augmented reality. The faith in itself is an augmented reality. There is this, the experience of life and faith. There is an osmotic new ecosystem, an environment that will collect, process, and produce information based on the data collected. Okay, the second thing. If this describes the dimension of Internet of Things, it is likely that we will soon live in even more immersive technological dimension of the Internet of Everything. The direct experience of the world will be accompanied by sensory experiences mediated by electronics. We will live, for example, some passages of the history of salvation by entering into it as a co-stars in augmented reality that will have an even greater impact on the sphere of emotional memories. And finally, the word of God could also become edible. Ruth, I think it is possible. Like the knowledge, as you referred previously, as we saw in the speech of Nicholas Negroponte at TED Vancouver in 2014. And this explanation, in fact, reveals an experience of the prophet Ezekiel eating the roll of the word before speaking to the house of Israel. The stomach, in the view of the Old Testament, is the place where the words are stored, and its digestion is the way by which we begin to learn and understand it. Although this knowledge, of course, will not be sufficient, the concept will be supported by experience, live experience. And it is only this which will make the world alive and active, as in the story of Ezekiel. The word become flesh. If you eat, you transform the world. One last suggestion. In the technology, biomedical, and communication fields, it seems that the keyword that brings many projects to life in the Silicon Valley today is disruption or radical change. We should not necessarily expect linear paths of evolution. Thank you.
Thank you, Father Marco. And I think that Father Marco really, I mean, I think we should give him another round of applause because he's the one who really worked hard for this round table. So I think that he deserves his work. And now we have our last panelist, who is Giulia Cananzi from The Messenger of St. Anthony.
So, first of all, I'm not an expert, I'm a journalist, so that's I don't know what the future can be, but I think that our reality, Messaggero di Sant'Antonio, has many hints of future. So first of all, what is Messaggero di Sant'Antonio? Many may answer that it is the most diffused Catholic magazine in the world. They would probably write, but this is only a partial answer. Messaggero di Sant'Antonio is a complex relational system, 117 years of age. It's centered on St. Anthony and on his basilica here in Padua. St. Anthony himself was a man of relation, as Father Mario said before. So relation is our basic nature. St. Anthony is also the saint of gospel and charity, of word and action. He's often portrayed with a book in one hand and a bread for the poor in the other. The relation then is also physical. That is why touching St. Anthony's tomb remains an essential experience for any devotee. These traditional roots have developed across 8 centuries, adopting new technologies and languages offered in every age, so that our relational system is a fruit of a long history. Our system has 3 hearts. Let's see the first heart. The editorial heart. 3 Italian monthly magazines belong to this part of the system. Messaggero di Sant'Antonio main edition, the one dedicated to the Italians who live abroad, and Messaggero dei Ragazzi, the edition for teenagers. There are other editions in different languages, English, French, German, and Romanian. These editions are not a translation of the main one, but independent magazine. Messaggero has created also a net with other reviews of St. Anthony in the world, for example, in Poland, in Brazil, in Portugal. This part of the system includes also a publishing house. The Italian edition has more than 400,000 subscribers. The whole editorial part counts more than 600,000 subscribers in the world. It is the most visible and touchable part of the system at the moment. Focusing on the Italian edition, it deals with every type of topic: society, world issue, religion, culture, and so on. The approach is journalistic. I mean that it is not confessional, but it proposes the Christian anthropological vision and the value of St. Anthony's and St. Francis' tradition. This approach helps us to reach also the non-Catholic and even the secular person. This is also one of the ways to answer to Pope's suggestion of reaching the existential outskirts. So let's see the second heart. Messaggero di Sant'Antonio has always had a great number of contacts with its subscribers. It has always adopted a one-to-one approach. About 20 years ago, the whole system received 30,000 content letters and 13,000 phone calls every year. Every contact received a personal answer, also in different languages. Using a paradox, let me see that we can say that we were one of the first 2.0 reality in the world long before the web started to exist. Today we receive about 152,000 contacts, personal contacts I mean, every year. The emails are increasing month by month. Today they are more than 40,000 per year. I have to add another thing. From 1995, on the occasion of the 8th century of St. Anthony's birth, this part of the system organized the St. Anthony Days that we continue to propose every year. The code we use in this part of our system is more personal and confidential. It is often more confessional and religious, and if required, even of a psychological nature. Let's see the third art. It is the charity heart. Messaggero di Sant'Antonio has also a charity, Caritas Antoniana, which realizes about 130 projects every year in more than 40 countries in the world. The majority are micro projects. The funds are the sum of little donations made by the subscriber. This is the bread of St. Anthony. The main promoters of Caritas Antoniana are the friars of the Order Minor Conventuals, who operates in different countries, but anyone can become a promoter of St. Anthony's charity. Is to say other religious orders, secular associations, even a simple subscriber. Who proposed the project has to share the values of the charity and the Franciscan option to the poor. So in some way we can say that also Caritas Antoniana is a sort of 2.0 charity. The language used by this part of our communication is a sort of experience language. That means a language used among people who share the same experience and values. So, in conclusion, we can say that the Messaggero di Sant'Antonio is not only a relational system. It is also a community beyond the internet community with a solid history and tradition. It conveys multiple aspects of human and religious experience and tries to answer deep existential needs at different levels, from intellectual to devotional. Its sections are both spiritual and material. So what does it mean for us to spread the word of God in the next 10 years? Of course, we don't know. We are trying to convey all this complexity in a new internet system, but it's too early to know what will be the result. In the next year, our system will be more and more integrated, surely, in the internet context. And this will strengthen our relational nature. From what I've told you up to now, our keywords are credibility, sharing, multi-level relations. We believe that this principle will continue to make the difference also in the future. In this context, we will use all the new technologies and codes to share with people the path of life and faith. Thank you.
Just the last thing, we are grateful to the Bishop Antonio for the gift of a moment of peace, un attimo di pace, because we are looking forward, and thank you very much.
I just want to thank, explain a little bit about Antonian Days, just if somebody is wondering what we do. I mean, since not many people can come to Padua, we have an average of 3 million people coming every year to Padua, but not everybody can come. And so, since 1995, we are taking the relic of St. Anthony to different countries. And I can assure you that was quite exciting when I was in India, and you know, to process with the relic of St. Anthony, having an elephant at my back. It was quite exciting. So I think that now we have to invite Monsignor Paul Tai to give a kind of conclusion.
Just very quickly to thank everybody for making possible this event. I've been working in Rome for about 7-8 years. Okay. I've been working in Rome for 7 or 8 years, and in that time, many people come forward to us with proposals for the church to engage with social media, with very centralized ideas, that one model that we should all follow in the church. What we have decided is that the best thing is then we attempt to learn together how we can best proceed. And this morning we had a very important meeting where we had the representatives from the different groups who have spoken here this evening, and we could talk about what's happening, what it's like trying to be among the first people in the church to develop a presence for the church in digital media. And it's an honesty that we can learn together. The key words nowadays is all about networks. In the church, we are automatically in a network. We belong to different communities that are already in relationship. And I think that model of learning together in networks is something that our time today has enabled us to do. One thing that Roderick mentioned was that need to find a new language. Many of us here have had to learn new languages. And you only learn new languages by making mistakes, by making terribly embarrassing mistakes at times. And the same way in the church, we have to learn a new language, and we will make mistakes. But as Pope Francis said, I would prefer a church accidentato, an accident-prone church, to a church that is closed. So one thing I want to thank people is the willingness to talk about what is positive in their learning, and also the mistakes we made that we can stop other people making. Finally, just the point I think about social media is that people want each of us to be authentic. In the gospel, there is that terribly frightening moment when Jesus turns to the disciples and he asks them, "Who do people say that I am?" And then he turns to Peter, "But who do you say that I am?" In social media, people want our answer. We can't hide behind theology. We can't hide behind the catechism. They want our personal answer. So maybe the key thing to remember is that all good communications starts with us. And we need to remind ourselves that we will only speak authentically of faith and of Jesus if we keep alive that experience of the presence of Jesus in our own lives. So when we think about a biblical festival, I think each of us has to be determined to be surprised again, to learn again about the love of God, so that therefore we can witness authentically, saying who we believe Jesus is, so we can share that with our brothers and sisters. So thank you all very much for your patience. Thank you.
Unfortunately, time is running very fast and we are not open to questions, so we have to close here because it's already very late. So I would like again to thank Bishop Antonio, Monsignor Paul Tai, and all the panelists for their, you know, deep, and I think we have a lot of thing to chew when we go home. Thank you very much and good evening.